is North America's, as we're in a champs, like, I'm just going to finish this point.
Yeah.
Their overall strategy and how the infrastructure in Korea and China had been so much greater in season two because all those teams had analysts and coaches. And at least the top teams in North America are beginning to have those things. We were talking with Falcon on the couch, how their coach has leveled them up so much this split. Alex Penn has been the analyst for Cloud9 this entire split. Halfway through this split, CLG brought on Monte Cristo, who has a lot of worldwide League of Legends experience as an analyst. So that's what they're doing to try to level themselves up, and we'll have to see as it works. I can't be more excited for Worlds.
It's going to be fun. Let's see if the Western world can put up a little bit of a better showing. I mean, Europe did great. They topped forward, but at least North America then, see if they can put on a better showing. The picks and bans coming through pretty deliberately here at this point. Twitch and Elise. I haven't seen Nien get Elise in a very long time. The Twitch, interestingly enough, being dropped away from Doublelift.
Yeah.
It's one of those good late game carry champions. Certainly Spray and Pray is worth being afraid of. We'll see what else they go for here.
Because CLG banned Twitch against Cloud9. And now Velocity banned it against CLG. I think that's just generally strong AD carry recently. We've seen a lot of successful Twitches lately, and honestly, it seems like Velocity is kind of banning themselves out a little bit because Maple Street's had some of his best games on Twitch, and Echo's had some of his best games on Ahri. While obviously, Link is an amazing Ahri.
Yeah.
But if you are to be believed.
Well, to be fair, he could have been trolling me. He said he's going to be victorious this game.
Did he spell it with a K?
With a K.
Okay.
So he might have mistyped or forgot how English works. But a couple of AD carry bands have gone.
They're not very
Maple
close
Street
together on the keyboard, so that would be.
Maybe he's got like a weird foreign keyboard.
Obvious.
Just the letters are messed up.
He's using Dvorak.
Yeah.
Instead of QWERTY.
I don't know where those letters go on Dvorak, but
that just flew over like 80% of our audience. Hopefully, we don't know. It's a different keyboard layout.
Yeah. Anyway, the Shen coming through for Chris though. That's
what
been
about Coleman. Have you ever seen that?
Which
layout?
One? No, I haven't.
Yeah, I've never used it.
That's fair.
Yeah.
It's actually hard typing passwords on a German keyboard whenever I cast an EU. I've got to remember the Z and Y are switched. If there's ever like an exclamation point, it's like shift quotes or something like that.
I hate that.
Yeah, that's hard to do. Special care. And passwords are all asterisks. So it's not like you can oh, oops, that one I got wrong.
I hate typing email addresses.
Because it's not shift 2.
Yeah. Worldwide problems.
Hashtag first world world traveler problems. Anyway, guys. So Chris coming in the top lane Shen. It's been successful for him throughout the split, I think. He's done a pretty good job in that champion. Catalogic Gaming still taking a long time making their own choices here. But, of course, these are wins that CLG definitely needs to bring up. So the Thresh, you called that one coming out here. The Zac, that's been so good for Nien for a while. Standard picks for these guys.
Third game in a row they've went with this combo. And they do a fairly specific thing that's helped them push turrets, which has been a problem with CLG in the past, is Nien will really overextend beyond the turret and basically fake an engage on Zac. And Chouster will throw the lantern back out to him. So Nien goes in, soaks up a bunch of damage to CLG's taking the turret. They lantern him out once they take the turret, and it's actually been working out really well for them.
It's a wonderful play, and it's been really good for these guys. NK Inc. though on the other side, playing more comfortable champions. In fact, Team Blue so far versus Team Green. They've locked in the Evelynn there for NK Inc. Echo, looking at Anivia. If you're lying to me, I'm going to be sad. I mean, I liked your Anivia play, but yeah. I had this pregame call and everything.
So if we got to see Meteos carry jungler and Victor in the same day, I would be pretty happy. Because Victor is my favorite mid champion to watch. You got my hopes up.
AD carry Kennen. There's still a chance.
Okay.
I mean, or Echo's a giant troll.
I'm wondering what Velocity's game plan is here going in, because as a team that has been eliminated, they are just playing the spoiler right now and essentially playing for pride. And at least during qualification, they were the team that would pull out the very unconventional strategies and succeed with them. And I was expecting to see more of that after they got eliminated, because there's been kind of no risk. But it seems, at least earlier today when they were had already been eliminated, they were just going with their standard things once again.
Yeah, I'd always wanted the entire split to see the jungle Ezreal strat come back out.
Me too.
And I asked them, and they're like, yeah, I feel like teams know how to counter it now. But like that was all I'd heard of it. And we thought like Velocity was the team to bring out a bunch of new crazy things that no one had seen before, that they were always the odd one out where people were kind of underestimating them. And you saw it immediately after they ran Ezreal. It got banned for the next couple of days. And then it just kind of disappeared from the lineups there. And it has always been strange to see teams not come back to these. But sure, they think it's been beaten. The Orianna, though, and Tristana, I mean, this is all standard Counter-Logic Gaming stuff. They're saying, yep, you gave us champs we'd like to play. We're going to keep running these.
At least with the Ahri ban as well, it puts Link back on Orianna. And even though Orianna is a very staple CLG champion, I actually feel like CLG has the most success where Link is on a more individualist champion and not as team-oriented. Even though he can play Oriana great, there's the victor.
So it's
even though he can play Oriana great.
Yeah.
Get to victor in a second.
No, yeah, so Oriana.
Yeah, he can play Oriana great. If he can't individually assassinate people, I feel like it limits their overall threat value, mm-hmm. and it puts too much pressure on Doublelift and allows teams to potentially assassinate Doublelift to win.
And you even look at this lineup, though, and so the Victor obviously coming through, the Blitzcrank coming through as well. Mm-hmm. You talk about Blitzcrank, he can assassinate people individually, but at the same time, you look at the Velocity lineup, they're so area of effect focused, you don't really have to go for a Doublelift first, even.
No. Victor can do whatever he wants.
Yeah.
Here we go. The teams are locked in.
Teams are locked in. So
at this point, all right, I'm going to check Echo's runes, because I personally think he's swapping champions. He's going to be playing Victor. All right, he's not going for move speed on Victor. I prefer move speed on Victor because he has a very short range on his Q, mm-hmm. and he needs that to trade in lane. And specifically what you do, everyone talks about how difficult the E is to land on Victor because it's a vector target. But if you have move speed and you walk up in Q and then actually just E right on top of them and drag really quickly, you don't have to worry about it because it's an instant cast E and you get both damages at the same time and you actually out-trade everyone regardless of if you had ability power quince or move speed quince.
Oh, nice.
But what Echo has done is he's actually went with ability power. I just clicked
armor MR
because they're messing with me. I'll get in the second.
I assume it's armor MR. Everyone runs armor MR yellow and blue.
Yeah. Obviously, it's ability power quince, but then split penetration reds. Because since he is getting in range so frequently, he will be auto-attacking a lot as well. So he's just trying to get as much damage out that way. I just wonder if Link's going to be able to just stay out of his zone since Orianna has so much control.
We'll see if it happens, of course. These guys coming into the game right here. Velocity looking to play the spoiler, bringing out something a little bit new. Was AD Kennen. They trolled even you. Definitely, I think they trolled CLG with that one because we just saw Kennen in the mid lane. But the victor coming through for Echo, and of course, on the CLG side, they came back for some comfortable picks as well. They got the Sejuani mm-hmm. back onto Big Fat LP since from the beginning of the split, actually, he'd been playing yeah. her. And kind of Logic Gaming, yeah, they're in the playoffs, but we saw these teams wanting to have a good seed in the playoffs. They're just like TSM and... No, they've actually got a loss to Cloud9, but if they can keep up and wins,
yeah.
they can go above Curse, and if TSM drops the game, they can tie or beat TSM head-to-head and take third place.
CLG still wants to jockey for position, and they obviously... want to have a lot of momentum as they move in here. And I look at this team comp as well, and I'm sure we mentioned already that it has a huge amount of area of effect potential. But specifically against Velocity, I feel like this is smart for them. Because Velocity has a track record of not being able to avoid the team fights in the right moments. Mm-hmm. The game I remember the most is when Cloud9 was against Velocity, and Velocity actually yeah. beat them pretty badly in the early game. But then... they just got comboed out by Cloud9 in the Dragon fight because Velocity just engaged in the wrong types of team fates. And that's one of the weaknesses for Velocity, specifically when they don't have that practiced strategic shock caller since Valrose had decided to leave the team.
Yeah.
And I think that CLG is going to try to exploit that.
Yeah, and actually, thinking of other sort of weird teamfight games, there was one, I think it was actually the second time they played Cloud9, or the most recent time, where they camped top lane really hard.
This was Velocity?
Yeah, I think it was Velocity.
Okay.
And they put balls down to like 0-5, and Chris was like massive on Rumble.
Yeah, that was the last game.
Yeah, but unfortunately, he was the only guy getting kills, and if they couldn't always line up the Rumble ulties, and so even then the teamfights couldn't quite work out. But you're right that the early game has always actually gone well for these guys. That's always been where the spoils have seemed to happen from Velocity. They get going. When it's Maple Street, I mean, to be honest, playing an AD carry who's fed in a teamfight's not that hard. You just shoot things and don't die to a tank, and you don't have to coordinate much. You just right-click people, and it's wonderful.
Yeah.
When Maple Street got going, and we kept talking about him in pregames, like if Maple Street gets going in this one and the prior games, he tends to carry through. And because one man coordinating an AD carry tends to be a little bit easier for these guys, we'll see if Velocity can do it with a more area of effect based team as they group up and go towards the right side of the map.
Apologies for the spam of pings that just came out after the pause. We did have to restart Link's client temporarily. That was the short delay, but we are back in the game now. And both these teams just doing the five-man mob strat right now, so not planning on running into each other by accident. They both decided to go for the same buff area.
I think you have to with a Blitzcrank, though. Like, anyone who's alone, if you just get hooked, because it's long enough range, you can just, like, blind guess brushes, right? And, like, if you're here, I can hook you from outside of a ward. So CLG staying on the move. If you hook any one of us, you'll have to deal with the rest. So
time to fight.
Yeah, power and numbers at the very least for these guys. Looks like just the wards coming across on both sides. Ooh. Golem buffs, And an interesting ward as well. Look at the ward by CLG towards Golem. It's on the other side near the lane.
Yeah, that's a ward that is very cute to me. And I like the placement because what this is going to allow CLG to do is have first knowledge of where Velocity's AD carry is going. But beyond that, since there's a lot of, when a 1v2 happens, there's a lot of lane support that comes up from the jungler that typically comes up through the lane or that part of the jungler, it will give CLG extremely advanced notice of when that's coming or when the person is going to be there to support the lane. So it'll allow them to make early informed decisions when stuff like that happens. That's a really cute ward, and I haven't seen a team in North America do that yet.
I wonder if NK gets to bypass that, though, being like depending on when he presses W, if he gets to bypass that and be invisible when he goes across
the ward.
That's
very true.
Could always be a bit risky.
It was also an explorer ward, so I should have noticed that was an explorer ward. That was only to see the early game lane assignments, in which case they wouldn't have cared about NK, because as you said, it wouldn't actually get to see NK since he would have been invisible.
Yeah, so NK ain't clearing out the rest of the blue buff there. Did get hooked away and stolen. Big Fed will peek out his own red buff and is making his way across to go try to steal away a blue buff for himself. So pretty much going to be the default buff trades for these guys.
All right,
making his way back towards the zone.
We got a Victor in the mid lane right now against Link. And I got to tell you, I want to see how he skills up his skills. Because personally on Victor, I like going 2 points into Q, which is his power transfer, and then 2, maybe 3 points, depending on the matchup, and then you max E and go for the red augment. But it's very important that you have the trade potential from the Q early on, since you can't keep up with the mana costs of E early if you want to have harass potential.
See what he goes for with this one. Chris, though, still getting zoned out in the top and actually getting surrounded by Big Fed LP. We'll see Echo scale up throughout this game, but right now the pressure is on this top lane, and NK is not here for the counter gank just yet. It's so far going to be a 3-on-1 under this turret.
And it appears we have a little spectator leg, but this is not affecting the players in-game. Here comes the dive.
There we go. The hook lands onto Chris. The rocket jump lands as well. Exhaust play. Everything going across. Chris getting chunked down by Big Fed LP. Tries to flash away. First blood still goes to double lift. So 1-0. NK late to the party. I don't think he's going to get to do much in this fight.
Yeah, that was a little bit too late to the party there. That was a well-executed dive by CLG here. And I think they're too low to go into another one as we watch the slideshow of them trying to go in. But I actually like how teams are still going for the 3v1 turret dives, even if they're not going for the turrets. They're instead going for the lane denial and maybe putting Chris in an even bigger hole than we could have seen previously.
He's definitely getting denied here. 0-1, only level 1. So that stand united going to be very far away. Now, NK did get the cleanup, so I guess much like last game, he'll get to be big this time around, and maybe he'll be the carry jungler as we saw from Cloud9.
Didn't get the kills, but he definitely got a lot of experience, which could be huge for Eve, because as soon as Eve hits 6, that's one of the most deadly ganks in the game.
And actually, I think his Shadow Dash actually got knocked back by play, so Chouser with a beautiful reflex play right there, shield coming down as well. That's going to allow Counter Logic Gaming to survive in that top lane. That could have been a very scary gank if that taunt had not been disrupted by Flay.
Yeah, I think that's what happened there. It's a little bit hard to see at this moment, but it was Chouster having immense comfort on Thresh. That's definitely something he's been working on as he's played, I believe now, 15 Thresh games, which is the most by far that any individual has played a specific champion this split.
So just, yeah, and we've seen him actually get better and better throughout the split as well.
Yeah, he doesn't even have a winning record on Thresh. Maybe he does after this week. I know before the day he didn't, but it's because he's put the time in to learn the champion that he's now very successful on it.
And it's funny because now you got to figure, are you going to start target banning Chouster again?
Yeah.
Like start putting, because it used to be Lulu bans at the very beginning, saying that was his only good champion.
This one might work.
Another regain coming. They land the taunt onto Doublelift, but Doublelift gets the lantern back. They couldn't block the lantern click.
That looked pretty cool.
Yeah, I'm
obviously not super happy about the glitchiness we're seeing in the spectator here, but the way he just appeared through the lantern, if everything could work that quickly, be easy to escape. Who needs travel times?
I just want a 5,000 range flash when there's Thresh on my team.
You would.
Yeah, I'm the AD carry player who overexpends all the time and needs support to save me. He does get the pull onto Big Fat LP, and we are going to get a game pause for ourselves real quick.
Try to sort this out real quick.
Yeah, so here we go. So, game definitely pretty interesting. Gold lead not that far apart, only 400. So despite the early kill, you know, the first blood obviously worth a little bit, definitely helps, puts Chris down. The rest of the game is actually going okay. Echo's holding up in his lane. You've still got a pretty much free farming Maple Street, and you've still got to see the team fights for Velocity where they've clearly geared themselves for it.
So very early on in the game, and it's something we've mentioned frequently, Velocity does play early game well.
Yeah.
They have given up the first blood, unfortunately, to Doublelift, which is
not
in all
best.
Of these games. Like, I feel like Doublelift has the first five kills in the last three COD games because he started two games in a row with a double kill. And then he got the first kill in this one. That's a very good thing for COG.
Yeah.
He's going to go out and say that one.
I think it's pretty strong for them. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, too, because we haven't talked about this in a while, but talking about Tristana as a champion, we talk about her sort of mid-game lull before you finish your first big item. Mm-hmm. Right? Doesn't have a lot of ability burst. You don't really want to rocket jump into a team fight and all that. So that actually had happened in the Cloud9 game where he did get the double kill. He started the game like 3-0. And yet, because he hadn't finished an item, got zoned out by a 0-2 Shen in a team fight. Mm-hmm. Like, Balls had pretty much the same start that Chris is about to have right here.
Yeah.
And Cloud9 played the team fight right to circumvent that advantage. And so even when things like that happen, and Doublelift gets massive and gets all kinds of scary, you can outplay gold, I guess, full stop. You can outplay people with a gold lead at certain times, and it's interesting to see those happen.
I'd agree. And Doublelift has changed the way he builds Tristana, at least in the past two games. Because if we look back to the start of the season, he would go big four items, essentially. It would be Infinity Edge, into Phantom Dancer, into Last Whisper, and then a Bloodthirster.
Mm-hmm.
But specifically after his Vayne build yesterday, where he went Blade of the Rune King and then Zephyr, this morning when he played against Cloud9, he went Blade of the Rune King first on Tristana to try to get back a little bit of that mid-game power, because Blade of the Rune King, once you buy it, does give you that extra dueling potential. And then he'd kind of, I imagine he'd use that as a Bloodthirster replacement later on in the game.
Yeah.
And then just go, he went Infinity Edge after that. So it's definitely a difference in build path for him.
And that's kind of the thing, just kind of to corroborate some of your points. Like, you don't usually buy two lifesteal items on an AD carry.
No.
You pick one, and I've been meaning to go back and do the math on, like, if I have Eye Edge, Phantom Dancer, Last Whisper, right, I'm going to hit this hard. I'm going to crit this hard per attack. Mm-hmm. Do I get more from 100 attack damage, which is like a 40% damage boost, because I'm going from like 240 to 340? Mm-hmm. Or do I get more from 25 damage and 40 attack speed? And I guess depending on the champion, you care more or less about attack speed. Tristana has free AS. Vayne and Kog'Maw just want more attack speed.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
I've been meaning to look at it. But
and specifically yesterday, as maybe something's going to happen here, so we'll have to track the action. I believe they're going for an extended gank here.
Jump in on Maple Street. He's going to survive this one, though, so nothing quite picked up.
Getting back to yesterday, when Doublelift did the Vayne build with Blade of the Rune King and Zephyr, I was very mistaken when I saw the Stinger. I was like, why would he build the Stinger? Because I didn't see the Zephyr build.
Mm-hmm.
But after looking at it and talking to some people afterwards, it does make a lot of sense, and Doublelift had actually spoken about it previously. So what it was is, since Blade of the Rune King is the early Vayne item, and since you're not multiplying crit that frequently later in the build, he is adamant that Blade of the Rune King to Zephyr is just superior than Blade of the Rune King to Phantom Dancer, because he no longer values the crit in that part of the game and instead would like the extra tenacity and movement speed that you get from Zephyr, since Zephyr is 10%, and he thinks it just works better on Vayne. So, Stinger on Doublelift, not a surprise.
Yeah, on purpose here, and it's actually something else I wanted to math out, because you still add Infinity Edge to the end of that build, and at that point, you're like, well, and he went for Banshee's Veil, of course, and part of that, I think, was the 3.10 changes that did buff Banshees, as you pointed out, during that game. And looking at that and saying, well, I'm going to miss the crits here, but NK Inc, though, going into this fight, pops the ulti. Evidence is joining the battle as well. Stun does not quite land from Echo. No, gets back for LP, and the Chaos Storm just bringing him down. Kill picked up. The burst coming across the tank jungler, and VES, the hook,
nice
lands
hook.
Onto Chouster. He's going to flay them backwards, but still taking damage. The damage going to come across. Echo finds another 1-0-1. Good pickups there for VES, and they've now got a gold lead.
And that gank did show a lot of the power of Eve once he's level 6, and that actually was a direct result of the minions he took in the top lane after Chris had given up first blood. It's why he had 6 so early. It's why Velocity was actually able to take on a 3v4 in the mid lane and come out on top. So that is a smart play by NK Inc, and he now needs to use that threat to continue to make plays across the map.
And he should be able to snowball forward. Look at him. He's 38 versus 18 in minion kills compared to Big Fat LP. He's a full level above. I gotta imagine he's close to 7 at this point because of the lane tax he's doing up here. As he shoves the lane out, this might be for turret pressure. It might be to let Chris back off. But you've got to keep following NK Inc through this game. He tends to be, he's at this point, got to be the big playmaker. And we'll see if Link can hold up his mid lane against Echo. And we'll see what happens to this duo as well.
And I want to talk about the mid lane again. because we touched on the skill order of Echo a little bit earlier, how I personally like to go with Qs on him, because the mana cost on E gets pretty prohibitive. But that's why we can see he's actually only put the 1 in Q and 4 in his E, but he's went with double Doran's Ring and a Crystalline Flask to make up for those mana problems and then still give himself decent trading potential and actually better wave clear since he has more points in his E.
So that's going to be the opening here for Echo. And as he gets a little bit more money, he can choose to go for the Augment Death as well. Costs 1,000, right, for the upgrade?
Yes.
He's only at 300 so far, so that's going to be a ways till he gets the upgrade finished. We'll see how that comes across. Echo also, to help with the Mana Woes, going to be donated blue buff here. So that's a different, or another difference between Meteos' Jungle Eve, is no blue buff chain to the jungler here. And that just might slow down NK Inc. See if that ends up happening. But look at the dual lane. This one's actually held pretty even, aside from just that early kill that Doublelift had gotten.
Yeah, and Link is actually trying to steal away the big raid, but he ends up getting it anyway. That guy. That was a good steal, actually.
The Command Protect guy, that's like her lowest damage ability, and it was still enough.
Yeah, that Command Protect was doing 74 damage.
60 plus 14.
You got it.
I looked over.
It's a long tooltip.
That wasn't memorized. I just looked. But I knew that the second number was the damage one, so.
You knew that, freak.
Yeah, I play Orianna. You play Victor. You know way more Victor facts than I do, though.
All right, here comes the gate bottom.
And this is going to be a pretty scary one. The submarine coming in. NK Inc. The stun. A beautiful stun by Big Fat LP, but it's not an... Oh, that hook was close. One kill still coming across. Chouster, unfortunately, 0-2. VES, that early game. We talked about it, and they're finding it.
They're performing quite well here, Chris, using that ultimate to come down. And this is the thing that Kobe talked about so much. With the increased armor of turrets, oftentimes the laning phase extends, which then gives the freedom there for Chris to try to ultimate down. It's most likely going to put extra pressure on that turret from Nien, but because they use the Shenault in the long laning phase to come down, they're able to get the dragon.
And look at the map adaptation by Echo as well. He said, okay, I'm going to give him my mid lane for a little bit, but I know if I show up top, I'll stop Nien from killing my turret. He's like, well, you don't need me for dragon, so I like that move. Echo keeping his lanes in a little bit of a better spot right there, and then Chris takes mid, he'll keep the turret alive too, so nice couple of moves there by Velocity.
Yeah, it's what you would call good rotations. A lot of these players talk about them a lot, and it's a very hard thing to see just on a general basis, but teams that know where the next turret to be pushed is going and then preemptively send someone up to stop it have good rotation, and that's something Velocity did very well there.
Beautiful job then by these guys. We're just seeing the dual lanes though not rotate much of anywhere, of course, with that turret going down, with but Dragon going down with Stand United on cooldown as well. We're back to the default lanes here. Chris getting himself powered up, and just like we kind of noticed a few weeks ago, the Spirit Visage Rush still going strong for the Shen, the lower cooldown, the magic durability as well, just tends to be that first item coming across.
We're going to be seeing a lot of that in the future here from both Shen and Zac, as they're very prolific top laners who really need the cooldown reduction as well as the increased sustain that it helps from all their abilities. It is the almost no-brainer for them at this point, especially in this game where there are magic damage junglers as well as two magic damage solo laners.
Yeah, so durability as much as you can. I want to see if Aegis does come across. I know we talked about it not getting bought much, but it's all a bunch of magic damage, so 20 MR.
And if anyone's going to build it, it's going to be Big Fat LP, because he loves to build the supportive magic items and not necessarily take too much farm.
We'll see if he can do it. He's still probably opening up with the Ancient Golem that we've normally seen from these guys, and he's not had that great game. 39 minions on him. Right, the big jungle item's already been completed. NK Inc. has his Lizard Elder. Big Fat LP doesn't have the completed item yet at all. He's still got some gold to go. So NK Inc. just got the lead on him here, and we're seeing Big Fat look for a gank still.
And NK Inc. really wants the next gank to come, but this is a little bit telegraphed. Evaniscus put down a pink ward very early, and it told CLG that they were probably trying to clear the way, since they can't let NK Inc. get seen by pink wards, and it's actually forcing Big Fat LP to go to a different area. But there's two ganks that's going to happen at the same time.
There we go. The fight at the bottom lane. A lot of burst coming across. Chouster gets pulled back in. That poor man cannot dodge a hook. But at the same time, the mid lane gank does succeed. Echo goes down. Big Fat went across the ward, but the CC too much from CLG.
And that was very close by Echo, almost taking down Link in a duel. But again, the gank in the bottom lane was so successful for NK Inc. CLG should have seen that coming, thanks to the pink ward being cleared out. And I thought they knew with the way Big Fat LP was going, but they hadn't seen him. And NK continues to surprise them.
Flashes forward, just jumps in and finds one, gets the reset on his move speed, and chasing on to Big Fat LP, doing about 100 damage per shot, but just won't quite do enough. However, the aftermath of that bottom lane gank was enough for a turret, so Velocity finding the first dragon and first turret of this game, despite CLG getting first blood.
And this is Velocity turning it on in the mid game here. They did all that, by the way, while Chris's ultimate was coming off of cooldown. Mm-hmm. It's back again for Shen, so any type of fight that CLG would want to initiate can get turned around by Stands United. This is a very dangerous point in the game for CLG.
Well, let's see if CLG can then maneuver around this. Of course, Big Fat LP finally getting time to himself to farm away the mid lane. He will have enough, I believe, for his big Golem Spirit here if he goes for it, which allows him finally to be a little bit tanky and have some cooldowns. And that just might help Sejuani a lot in these team fights.
Yeah.
But Velocity, look at that. The pull on the blue buff. They're using Evidence goes pretty well on this one. Nice move by Echo. Puts out a Stun Cloud just in case. Steals away the blue. And it's a nice little buff grab.
I like Victor.
Yeah.
Now that he's got his red augment, he can clear the back wave in one shot, and then an auto attack after the E will burn off on the front wave is enough to take that out as well. So he should not be slowed down in farming, and he can actually do that from a very safe range now that he's made it to this 14 or 15 minute point. The actually very early laning phase of Victor is his weak point. Now he's actually very strong in lane.
Now we'll see if he can just keep pushing ahead, because he's got a 20 minion deficit to Link, to be fair. 1-0-1 to the 0-1-1, 20 minion kills down. Neither turret's been destroyed in the mid lane either here. But you're noticing Link, look how far back that Orianna is playing. You've got Evidiscus around here, you've got the wave clear coming across, and the rest of VES kind of moving towards the mid lane, but they're outnumbered. You've got Big Fat LP just in the wings.
Oh, look out!
Good flash right there. He's going to survive against that one. Chris, oh, the immovable objects in the top lane. Going to sustain against each other. They're fighting minions in on top of each other.
They're having fun up there.
Not a big deal. Spirit visage both sides. Yeah.
What's the big point of contention here is this mid lane, and it's crazy how Velocity has actually been able to have so many well-prepared 3v4s in the mid lane, where Maple Street is able to kind of just get back some farm in the bottom lane by himself.
And the jumping in onto Nien, though, his ulti is available. Here comes the ulti in from NK Inc. Dodging right by, but gets knocked up by Nien. There's the ulti coming by as well. That is enough to get Nien out there. So just the ulti. Well done.
Very timely skill usage by Nien there. He got not only the knockup when he went over top and barely landed on NK Inc., but then he had the presence of mind to ult him backwards as well to continue that escape. It puts Nien's threat level way down in the lane, but it gives him the survivability that he needed.
And they spotted Evelyn, so they know the rest of their lanes are safe. And yeah, look at that. Double lift and Chaucer happily pushing down from and out. The dual lane from VES has come back, though, so no turret pressure there. But CLG knows, guys, the dragon's coming back up. We're going to set ourselves up for it. You can see the team congregating around. Link just back, got himself some new items. Even bought a Ruby Crystal for some durability. And Echo, he's got his ulti. This is going to be a likely standoff at the dragon.
What's Link got that Ruby Crystal for?
Haunting guys?
That's probably the only thing he'd go for. That's not something I've seen him build this early on Orianna. But he's going for it this game. I'm not entirely sure why he's decided to go for it this early.
Maybe it's Spectre's Cowl. He's afraid of the Victor Burst?
I mean, potentially. We just got to have to keep track of that and see how it goes through.
Watch, it'll be like really obvious. And we're like, oh, duh, yeah. Of course.
Oh, that item.
Yeah. Pull a Zephyr on us. Damn it, CLG. Stop it. What? Looks like the mid lane push not quite going to succeed. The wave clear from Echo, pretty good. And Chris didn't even have to leave his lane. So pushing out the top lane, doing a good job of that one. And of course, Velocity, they got the dragon without much worry. Didn't have to let Chris leave. Just control here for Velocity.
Yeah, they're doing a great job here. And we mentioned a couple minutes ago how this was a dangerous point in the game for CLG is because they don't have the ability to force things well right now. They're such a team fight oriented team, and Velocity hasn't given them the windows to do that. Additionally, Doublelift is very weak right now in the game when compared to Kennen, so they're in a lot of trouble as they roam around.
Oh, Doublelift's gonna jump away, has to flash it. Evidence is not gonna quite land the hook because of that one, but the push in the top lane, NK Inc. has to burn his ulti once more, this time traded for NK Inc.'s though. So it's going to be ultis down in top lane.
And all these turrets for CLG are getting chipped away, whereas Velocity's turrets are completely healthy. So CLG needs to make a counterattack, but they're weak enough that it might actually end up losing them the game.
Let's see if they hold on for these, though, if they're just going to grit their teeth and try to defend. Even though they've got the 4,000 gold deficit, this could balloon forward. Nien forced to jump backwards. unfortunately, has no Thresh to make his plays less risky here. So, another turret goes down. Velocity, 5-2 in kills. 2-0 in turrets, 2-0 in dragons, if I have my numbers correctly. It's looking good for these guys.
And there's a lot of action still in the middle lane, but look at the wave clear coming out from Echo. He stops the creeps, but since the turret was so low and there was four people there, they were still able to get that. We can actually see Echo's going probably towards a death cap, and that's good as a rushed item on Victor,
yeah,
because the red augment gives him so much overall ability power that it then gets almost extra multiplied by the death cap and allows him to do absolutely absurd damage once he picks up that combo.
Yeah, just to put it out for you right now, 84 AP from augment death. That item costs 1,000 gold and gives him 84
people
ability power.
People complain about having that item.
I have to spend 1,000 gold on a lot of ability power. This
sucks,
guys.
On one of the most efficient items in the game.
So, nice ability power gains here for Echo. And I actually want to see if NK Inc. goes Abyssal, because it'll help Echo do even more damage. Mm-hmm. We saw Meteos grab it in the last game, and he went for Haunted Geist Slurk Shoes so far. And hey, Link did go for Haunted Geist. We got it. We got it, Jack.
Boom.
Fist bump right there. So let's see if they can keep the game snowballing forward. Velocity. Whoa, he hooks the cannon minion. Evaniscus, 100% accuracy.
You know what? The Haunting Guys is a reaction to the fact that Velocity isn't going to build an Aegis. Because flat pen, the closer you bring someone to zero, multiplies your damage even more so.
Yeah.
So since he can take people closer to zero with his flat penetration, that's the most damaging item Link can do, as well as giving him the extra survivability from the health that he gets from it.
Beautiful stuff right here. And of course, the Golem being hooked away again. Echo getting jumped on, though. Big Fat LP wants some of this. This could be a really scary engage. Echo already has burned the channel and just goes down. And won't quite find enough damage on a Link, but Shouster's dropped low, kicks him back through the box. NK Inc. low on HP, forced to flash out, but here comes the re-engage. Do they have the damage? Evidence has dropped so low, two kills for nothing. CL drew the beautiful team fight so far. Maple Street forced to run away, and Chris, of course, could not show up to the party as Echo died too fast.
And this is exactly the thing Velocity wanted to avoid to maintain their lead. They got an off-man team fight, and CLG forced in the right place since Chris ulted, but did not make it in before Echo died. It turned into essentially a 3v5, and Maple Street hadn't even arrived yet, so that was close to a disaster as it could become for Velocity in that engagement.
Good stuff then by Counter Logic Gaming. Even though their blue buffs had been stolen over and over again, they knew the timer and grouped up for it, knowing the next attempt was coming through. But of course, they still haven't yet found that answer to Chris. They first blooded him at level 1, they made his life miserable, but Chris is about to work down his second turret. Even if he's not outlast hitting yet, he's putting a heck of a lot more pressure on the map.
He absolutely is. And Echo, of course, getting his blue buff back once again. I want to see if CLG is able to use this to kind of swing the game around, because they actually still need a lot more time to develop. Double lift, nowhere close to the items he actually wants to get. Obviously, Link is pulling a bit of an edge on Echo, and he's actually picked up those home guard boots so he can recall frequently to just almost keep up with the amount of pressure that Echo's been putting onto that mid lane. But Link is actually obliterating Echo in minion kills, so I gotta say, Link is doing a great job on Ori here.
It's putting them pretty equal, I would say, or actually you can see for yourselves. They put them pretty equal in gold, but
yeah,
that's on the back of Velocity controlling globals, right? Getting
dragons.
Blue buff steals their 80 gold each, so despite all that, again, as you said, props to Link. He is holding on very well, and he's done a good job of this one. NK Inc. still getting a lot of this free lane farm. I want to keep comparing these junglers, though, because it's such a difference in style. NK, 123 minions on Eve. He's actually tied his top laner, Chris, for that mark. Big Fat LP, pretty much half that score. He's always wanted to be supportive, but a little bit tanky, and giving up farm to his teammates.
It's a big difference in jungle style right here, because Eve and NK Inc. specifically playing Eve can take a lot more farm, whereas Big Fat LP is all about channeling the farm into his soul laners and AD carries. So, yes, Link has that edge on Echo, but as you pointed out, a lot of that could be because NK Inc. has taken more jungle and Big Fat LP has conceded some of his farm to Link.
Let's see if then if that ends up being the right call. If NK can carry through the mid game, or if Link just becomes the guy who cannot be stopped.
Yep.
And here we go. Big Fat LP forced back. Of course, there's not even a dragon up right now, so they don't need to fight for this territory, but there's the pink ward control. Velocity are in full view with CLG grouped up. There is the dragon. they have begun contesting.
This is a very key team fight right here. CLG wants to be able to combo their initiations properly, but they can't get hooked in to start this fight unless a tank is hooked in. There goes Nien, just flying in by himself.
NK's in the back. He ults onto three right here. Gets a slow down, and Nien is now alone because of this. The box has come across. The taunt comes in. The submarine has happened. NK being taunt. Oh my god. Three-man shock of it. Here's the re-engage. There's the Chaos Orb. It finds one for one so far. Big Fiddle P gets out. Maple Street is still alive, and Double just duels him out right there. They're trading kills. They've got to get rid of Nien. He's reviving, though, off the passive, and Doublelift still untouched. NK Inc. forced to run away. Doublelift diving on forward, finding more. Link dangerously Echo. Low. Echo finding the kills. NK Inc. trying. He gets one more. Nien has no passive. Echo, can you do it? Finds one more. Echo does not have flash. Link will run away. The only man alive. Velocity won that fight.
That fight I want to see again because there was so much chaos in there. The teams got split up at the start of that one, and no one could even take the dragon. So let's break down this fight right away. Watch how Nien essentially fights everyone while NK Inc. gets shot back as Shen came in for him. So at this point, the fight is very split up. It's all about the re-engage. And as CLG lands their combo on Velocity, Echo lands his ultimate on CLG, which takes everyone extremely low. And then right here, Velocity could have actually won the fight. If Echo used that laser to finish off Zac, everyone would have disengaged right there. But because Nien was able to res up, it baited CLG to continue fighting. Chris landed the taunt, Doublelift did not expect that burst, and then Velocity and the near 400 ability power Echo has accumulated this game rolled through the end of the fight.
Beautiful stuff right there. A storm of chaos in that one, but it worked out in the end for Velocity. However, their health bars were low enough that CLG are going to recontest the dragon. They had to heal.
Velocity needs a couple seconds here. Victoroth is not up. CLG goes now. They have an edge.
But the taunt flash lands on a double. Do they have the damage they need? Beautiful stun combo just crushes the health bars. One kill picked up so far. This is looking pretty good so far for CLG. Maple running back, but there's the Chaos Storm. They've traded back a kill, but down goes NK Inc. and Chris tank everything up enough. Nien re-engages, finds the kill onto Echo, and there are no health bars left. Velocity's going to lose almost one more kill. Chris does go down, only Maple Street left alive. Nien is on the chase though, under the turret, he finds it, the turret not doing enough damage. Full ace for CLG, only losing Chouster.
Great timing on CLG, having the presence of mind to know that their ultimates were on lower cooldowns than those of Velocity, and all the spells got used to punch Velocity in the mouth. Check this one out. They have the Orianna ult up. Echo has to wait for his ultimate until partway through the fight. He can't use it yet. The Ori ult hits everyone. Nien starts ulting around as well, and only later in the fight, I think now Echo gets to point his ultimate down. But the damage had kind of already been done for Velocity, and the rest of COG could then chase him down. Additionally, Echo was out of mana later in that fight and allowed COG to just king me and jump all around the fight to finish people off.
I gotta say, I'm a really big fan of reinventing that one.
Yeah.
The King Me jumps for Tristana. Well done. And I actually, just to kind of go back on all this one, the Athenes and Holy Grail, right? You talk about the cooldowns being back up and the mana bar no longer there for Echo. Link's Athenes made that fight happen.
Yeah,
basically.
For Link. Absolutely.
Yeah.
20% cooldown reduction right there as well. Because if we compare it, let's check. The Command Shockwave is now in a 70-second cooldown thanks to his 20% cooldown reduction. But there's a 92-second cooldown on the Victor ultimate since...
With blue buff.
So it's not necessarily comparable.
And actually, to point out some more item builds, I think this is actually on purpose. Maple Street has gone for double Zeal after his Blade of the Rune King. He's getting a lot of movement speed to make that Slicing Maelstrom hit proper targets. I think that is on purpose, because you don't get more move speed from getting to Phantom Dancer. You only get 1% more for going Static Shiv.
Yeah.
So I think that is an intentional choice, just trying to zip around his cannon.
Could have just built a Zephyr.
Could have just gotten
that 10% movement speed right there.
And the Tenacity. NK Inc. though, forced to run away from Doublelift. This is actually giant crits into his face. Chris, lands the taunt, but NK Inc. still forced to flash away. Big Fiddle P jumped across the wall as well, but won't quite find anything else to do. So, flash burn from the Velocity jungler. Nothing else happening.
So, with all the fighting that just happened, where we had the back-to-back hectic dragon fights, CLG did pull themselves back in this game. But I don't think they're entirely over the hump yet. They were down a lot, and we do see this a lot from Velocity where, hey, they won the early game. They take a bunch of unfortunate fights at Dragon, and then the other team takes it back. This is a chance then for Velocity to try to kick that trend as CLG seems to be on a warpath back here because they've won that big fight.
Yeah.
They've been catching Velocity out, and we know that CLG wants to team fight. Velocity hasn't been able to prevent those from happening.
Well, at least Velocity can realize that they're only 300 gold away. So missteps are not, early game leads are not. 4-3 in turrets, very close. Kill score very close. Gold almost identical as well. But Nian's going to dive in early on and try to blow some cooldowns, but no one's going to bite just yet. Submarine comes in. Will the Shen ult do much here? Nian gets pulled back in on the stun as well. The ult from Big Fat LP stops the re-engage, but that still gives the free kill to Velocity. Now they can move forward.
So we talked earlier about CLG's strategy of having Nian zone out while the rest of the team kills the turret and then get him back on a Thresh Lantern, but Velocity almost over-engaged that one and pulled CLG far enough back that no one could go and rescue him, so he ended up dying.
A good zoning, good everything here by this Velocity squad. And now they're up on the front door. It's a 5v4 with every major ultimate still available. They find Big Fat LP, knock him into the air. Good bit of burst. Secondary stun won't quite land from Victor, but they have done some initial work here. They've got 6 seconds until Zac comes back up. It might just be enough to push for the turret, but they won't go for it.
They have to be very cautious about where they go if they're Velocity right now, because they know about how badly they've been losing the team fights and how much farm has been channeled into Lynx Orianna. 3-1, along with over 312 mini kills, not even 30 minutes in. He's really packing a punch right now. So if they get caught in the wrong place by the shockwave, even if that was the only big ultimate up for CLG, it would have been enough to swing the fight.
The ES looked for a little bit of a bait here. They might find double if there he is. They see him. Can they get the damage they need? Eve ult lands. Double does have flash. He's going to be able to get away from that one. But summoner burned here. That's it, though. Evanescence actually burned his own flash to get in range, but couldn't quite find it.
Yeah, Velocity burned a lot to try to take that one down, but that's the strategy teams actually adopt against CLG, specifically when Doublelift is 4-1 on Tristana. Mm-hmm. If they could have gotten him out of the picture, it would have meant a very easy push for them afterwards. I think it was worth the investment to try. It just didn't work out.
And speaking of Doublelift, you know, look back at his build here. The Infinity Edge has now finished. He's added a Pickaxe and a Negatron Cloak, so he's going to stop getting bursted out so hard by Evelynn and Victor. And he's scaled up as a legitimately very scary AD carry at this point. Compared to Botter K, Zeal Phantom Dancer, that's not nearly the same kind of damage output here from Maple Street.
No, Kennen as an AD carry is all about the lane and the middle of the game. It's not even a real comparison about who's going to be stronger if they hit 6 items right now. So Doublelift and CLG, even though they're actually forcing pretty hard here because they want a team fight, will also have the edge very late in the game.
So that's always the CLG mantra. They're going to have the edge later in the game. Yes, you will, kind of Logic Gaming. Doublelift, you like to farm, and buying items is your thing. This turret losing health pretty rapidly. A couple more shots to go. Velocity not really challenging for position. Turret does go down. CLG equalized that score 4-4. And in the meantime, Chris has just been pushing in that top lane, trying to be a nuisance. But CLG now the ones owning the map.
Yeah, and it's on Velocity, I think. They're trying to force some scatter movements by CLG right here. They're using Chris, obviously, as a split pusher. And I think, actually, CLG could have some answers for that. Normally, CLG actually uses Doublelift Tristana as a split pusher to answer that. And since Chris is so far behind in overall gold right now, I actually feel like Doublelift could be a pretty good answer to that. But instead, they're just using it to farm up, and they're sending Nian up there as well to duel. The longer this goes on, the better it is for CLG, as long as Velocity isn't forcing decisions by CLG and instead just kind of forcing them to stall.
Well, they might have another chance here. Oh, the ward swept out by the Oracles. Doublelift lurking around in the shadows, but baiting around for his team. You've got Link nearby. The blue buff steal attempted, though, by Velocity might just be enough. Will Link go for this one? Steals it away!
Oh,
nice job, Link. And NK Inc's smite was up, but he wants to save it for this dragon spawning now.
And that really hurts Echo, because he's built no mana itemization. He would run out of mana if we see a very extended fight here at Dragon. NK Inc's gonna start it!
They dive on in, there's a slicing maelstrom as well, and he dodges the ulti in from Big Fat LP. A lot of early damage coming across. Echo low on health, Shockwave hits 2 right there. NK Inc forced to back out. Chris still tanky though, lands on top, they find Doublelift into the stun! Dies out! And the Chaos Storm finds a second. 2 kills now for Velocity. The dragon is theirs. Pretty well done team fight.
That was NK Inc creating a play.
Yeah.
Putting himself inside the Dragon Pit was the last place CLG expected to see him. And even though CLG has superior team fighting, it allowed Velocity to get the jump on CLG big time.
Absolutely beautiful. And they're going to try to cash in on that fight with a Baron.
Yeah, but check out just the initiation. Getting the ultimate onto everyone and making it so NK Inc. was not a realistic target for the start of that fight. As now Velocity is going to be taking a Baron afterwards. You can see Velocity just moved in, got the stun down for the zone, and Echo popped a perfect Chaos Storm and E that just wrecked him out. Here comes the Baron contest, though.
Big Fat LP does have Smite up, but so does NK Inc. Evanescence is getting jumped around. Blue team has slain Baron Nashor, and there we go. Big Fat LP, the pull in on Link. That's huge.
Ooh.
A shutdown coming across. A lot of damage. The Stun Cloud does land onto Nien. He's got a flash away, but is burning down to very low HP. Still, three kills of Baron and a Dragon to Velocity.
Just a continuation of the play that NK Inc. made at the Dragon. They made another bold call, and why not? They have nothing to lose at this point in the season. They're just trying to play spoiler and actually how good get a 3-1 season series lead over CLG if they're able to win this game.
And I mean, CLG have been looking like one of the better teams this split. They're in the top four, right? They're doing a very good job. And you look at your resume and you're like, look, we were clearly able to take down some of the top teams here. We've won laning phase against most of them. We've won games against a few overall. Velocity, you have to think, okay, well, look, we can use this at least for practice for the relegation later on this year or the beginning of next. And we're gonna see them again. We're gonna see them at least fighting for their jobs here and trying to just continue to do well.
And I actually think that Velocity might try and push this fairly quickly right now because Echo is a huge threat. He has 647 ability power right now on Victor, so he can single-handedly kill Double If through that Negatron Cloak if he lands his E, Q, and Alt on top of him. So any type of engagement they can get is a good one. And
they
there's a hook.
Pulled Chouster. Evanescence is the mayor of Hook City. I'm sorry, Chouster, but that is the case here.
And this makes this turret even more disastrous to hold. I don't know how many times I've seen teams try and hold this turret, but teams will walk around the back and just kill them and then get an inhibitor. So COD is smartly pulling away here because that turret at this point in the game is indefensible.
And at this point, they have to. They realize it's a 5v4. They already made the mistake once. Even though they had a pink one off to the side, it wasn't enough to spot everyone out here. And now the siege comes through. Almost on the Double Lift.
By the hair of his chinny chin chin, he couldn't get that one. That would have potentially ended the game.
Yeah.
That's how close it is for Velocity right now.
This is going to be nice for them. They can continue on through. Guardian Angel now done for Chris. He can faithfully ignore the back line in a team fight. If they spend the time to kill Chris, I feel like the rest of his team should be killing off CLG. So Link is on defense duty. Chris not wanting to tussle straight up 1v1, but you've still got to realize the minions are pushing in towards the CLG base here.
Obviously, the Static Shiv is the second Zeal completed item for Maple Street, so he did make use of both of them. And there's only about a minute and a half left on this Velocity Baron, so I think they want to go right now. It's still a dangerous fight because we know the team fighting potential of CLG, but it's the moment where Velocity needs to go if they want to actually win this game.
We'll see if they can dodge the ultis properly. Evanescence sweeping away the pink wards here, making sure that he is in Fog of War when looking to hook enemy champions. There you're seeing the scattered vision wards by Counterlogic Gaming looking for where does Blitzcrank go? Where does Evelynn go? What's the opening?
Yeah, Velocity ran out of oracles and pink wards, so they can't actually clear the vision outside. And even though Velocity knows they need to go, they still want to find a window because if they walked in with an uncoordinated fashion, they would just lose their Baron buff and give up their lead. So that's why they're trying to deny vision, and Evanescence is trying to land a hook. Anything works for them here, and they will dive without fear.
Well, there's a taunt on the Double, dropping him down a little bit low. Double just lifesteals it back up with a pretty well-completed item build here. Evanescence shows up as well, doesn't quite find it. The engage
the
comes
fight.
Up. They find Echo, but he flashes out. Chaos Storm should be coming in soon. Goodbye to Big Fat LP. Echo still losing health, and Chris will channel in. It's NK Inc. who is so tanky. The engage, the taunt lands on Double. He's going to cleanse out of this one, but it's still a 1-0.
Just the one kill, and they did not get turret damage off of that. COG disengaged that fairly well, and there is a sliver left on the Baron. It is now gone, so that means they actually can't sit out here and regen. I think they have to back away, but they're continuing the push.
There's a couple of home guards picked up for COG. Double Lift is back in this battle. It is a 5-on-4. The hook lands on a Chouster. He's got a flash away from this one, but that's still a bit of an advantage, but it won't be the turret.
They hooked him while he was trying to hook.
Yeah.
punishing him for that half-second channel time that Thresh has to go on his death sentence. I actually wouldn't call that push a great success for Velocity,
okay,
because they didn't get turret damage, and they didn't capitalize on their Baron. I'd say they got an edge mm-hmm. when they got the Baron, but they didn't make maximum use out of it, which tells me that CLG still has a chance to repel Velocity's pressure and maybe scale up a bit more.
Definitely got a good chance of it. Doublelift still scaling up. 301 minion kills. 370 on Link, to be fair. Look at that. He's got more Magic Pen. He's got the Void Staff added on top, the Death Cap, the Haunting Guys. Link, mm-hmm. you know, we talked about it in the pregame, right? If only Doublelift is the major threat, it's a risky proposition for CLG, but yeah. Link is clearly aiming at dealing damage here.
Absolutely. I mean, this is the point in the game where Orianna is very clearly a second threat, and it's in the teamfight phase. So Link can make the teamfight wins almost by himself. And this is also the point in the game where, remember the red augment we talked about for Victor mm-hmm. earlier? Everyone says this is the point in the game where it bites him, because it's 1,000 gold, technically 1,000 gold item, that he can't sell. Effectively, until once he upgrades that Haunting Guy's Chilliandri's Torment, he is done on items. Yes, here's my take on it, actually. He hits 6 items faster, but it's actually not a punishment for him, because that red augment, if I could pick a 6th item, that would be the 6th item for his Victor build as far as maximum power, because it's giving him so much ability power.
99.
And it's augmenting his E so well with extra damage as COG's looking for a fight. But what it does mean for COG is that Ekko has hit that 6th item point very quickly, and the longer they wait, the more they're going to catch up. It just means Ekko is far ahead from them right now, but can't get any farther ahead.
We'll see then if CLG can make those traditional hour-long games happen. It's when they tend to win their games most. You saw a little while ago the average game length for these teams. Velocity has passed theirs. CLG hasn't gotten to theirs yet so far. So yeah. You're still seeing CLG playing a shorter game right now than they're used to, but they'll get there eventually. Doublelift, just he hasn't had 6 items yet. Of course not.
He needs 7 items. He's got to sell his boots for his Zephyr. To me, that's his 6.5th item.
When you buy a blue elixir on an AD carry, that's when you know you're done buying things.
Yeah, that'll be the day.
I want those 2 seconds cooldown off of my rapid fire, thank you. It's actually a decent DPS boost. Actually, interestingly enough, to tell a story about buying blue elixirs, Dan Din, when he used to play competitively, yeah. would go blue elixir on Rammus to lower the okay. cooldown on defensive ball curl. So that's nice. A higher effective health increase than red elixir.
It's very true.
It's probably true, yeah.
That's a cute move. And at this point in the game, this is just going to be the team fight. Unexpected.
Just dives right in, but kicked over the wall. The hook still lands on a Chouster, and the re-engage comes across. Bigfoot LP just drops down, tries to flash away. Doublelift and Link still alive, though. The major carries. Evidence is burning down from Ignite, and he will fall. And Nien's going to run away, so a 2-for-1 so far. Maple Street looking for a lot of damage,
wow.
but gets crushed out right here. It's a trade, though. Doublelift falls over. The Chaos Sword was held onto. Ekko running away, but Nien wants to bring him down and does so. 2 kills for Nien. Link running away, but doing a bunch of damage to NK Inc. They're going to have to turn away. So a 3-for-3 here. Nien's not done. Gets taunted up. Still 1,000 health on Nien. Gets this done. NK Inc, can you run away? Oh my god. Nien picks up 3 kills in this fight. He's going for the 4th. Chris does not have many places to go. Knocked up as well. Nien burning him down. That's going to be the GA forced. And I can breathe in while I wait.
And the death timers in this are so long that we may just see a reset afterwards. Oh, nice dodge by Chris. He's surely going to die.
It's likely here. He's yeah. burning down. Link's going to show up. Who's going to take the kill? Chris walking sideways. Okay, Link's going to pick it up. So between Nien and Link, I think those were all the kills in the team fight.
Yeah, and that was actually a very surprising turnaround here. Let's check out the initiation, because CLG got surprised. Evolve came in perfectly at the start, and Chouster didn't get to use skills. But then, even though Velocity took out such a chunk on them, it's that Link threat we are talking about. Velocity feels like they're on top of the world here because they think they can end the game. It's a 4v3 at this point, so watch the shockwave right there. Essentially, Maple Street and Doublelift traded their lives. And since Ekko used his ultimate there to take out Nien, it just became a long chase afterwards. So, surprise early by Velocity and a great counter initiation by Link.
Beautiful stuff. And that might just reward CounterLogic Gaming with a Baron for themselves. Doublelift shooting from across 12, that 700 something range. And here comes the attempt by VES.
Yeah, we've seen before COG rush to objectives right after teamfights, and again, it's perfect timing for them making very decisive decisions after big teamfights.
And think about how sort of delayed a lot of those deaths were. Chris is still reviving, and Cake was still leaving base, even though he bought Homeguard boots. Mm-hmm. They died so late that COG got taken out without a lot of threat on them. And again, you talked about the good decision making there, taking it right after the fight. They got it here. Now NK Inc. on cleanup duty for these minions, but CLG have put themselves a bit closer.
It seems strange to think that if Chris wouldn't have tried to survive, that could have been Velocity making it back to contest the Baron. I'm trying to think, is that true or is that completely off?
No, I think if he'd survived longer, he would have let more of his team revive.
He would have. But then he also is delaying his own life coming up later, you know, because that was like a 3v5 yeah. engage. I think in some situations that would be a good yes. thing to do, but not particularly in that one.
It was actually a game, I think it was from last Split's playoffs. There was someone stuck in the top lane rush.
Yeah.
And it was like, Vulcan was involved, and they were like, we refuse to kill you. Mm-hmm. Because if you die, you can get back to your base. And if you recall, you get back to your base, we'll leave you up there.
Yeah, enough of waiting around because COG has decided to just go right away. They're taking their Baron buff in the 5v5 and making it count because Velocity is trying to split push.
They've already found one kill right here. Chris does have ulti. NK getting a giant shield right here, but might still drop down. Pops the Zonius. One kill picked up so far. That's two kills picked up, but Link is still around. NK forced to run away. Double kill
double
now for
too
Link.
Strong.
He is killing everybody. Chris dropping down as well. Echo dead. And that's only NK Inc. alive. Wonderful teamfight for CounterLogic Gaming.
This looks like it could just be the end of the game. Doublelift has got his four items. Link is powered up. They win another teamfight with Baron, and they're on to the Nexus turrets.
And here we go. Only NK Inc. is here. That's not going to stop Doublelift. That's going to be the second turret falling as well. CLG, 7-6, 21-21. Man, they have earned it, but they've taken down the Ooh. Nexus. CLG, and you look at their faces, they're like, all right, we did it, but that was not pretty.
They beat Velocity, which has been a struggle for them all season long. Something about this Velocity team is difficult for CLG to deal with. They fought through this one, mm-hmm. but CLG had to make a lot of big plays in this game in order to get that win. So even though they look a little bit demoralized because CLG feels like to make a move towards World Playoffs, they have to, you know, crush Velocity.
Sure.
But I think this is a big step forward for them. If CLG can find some shred of consistency and still play solid in any game and overcome adversity, like, that's something you have to do. You
yeah.
need to be able to come back in games, and they did it in this one.
You think about the teams that have done that so far. I mean, look at the major comeback. Like, Cloud9's had a couple now where, man, they got destroyed early on. CLG actually did that to them. Where
yeah.
CounterLogic Gaming had a really big early kill lead, the double kill on Doublelift. Vulcan's done it to him a couple of times where there was the like 11-1 kill score comeback a couple of weeks back, right? Even the best teams in North America, and obviously CounterLogic Gaming can consider them one of that crew, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, early game deficit, but knowing how to come back and claw your way up regardless of who your opponents are.
Yeah, and I guess this moves CLG to 2-1 now mm-hmm. on the Super Week.
Yes.
It should be a good amount of momentum for them, honestly. It didn't seem clean, but I do think the comeback, and at least the team fights they had near the end when they made the decisive calls to go for Dragon, and specifically the one at the Baron near the
yeah.
end, are good signs for them
yes.
long term.
Keeping your head in the game, very important mm-hmm. for these guys. An emotional team always wants to be able to keep their heads in the game.
Yeah.
So, congrats to CLG. And now we've got to take a short break, but when we come back, we're going to be joined with CLG's Doublelift. Then it's time for our